Second Edition News with Anne Fulwood.
Good evening. The 20-year isolation of South Africa tonight is coming to an end. In less than 3 hours from now, the US President George Bush is expected to announce his country will resume full trade with South Africa. The rest of the world is expected to follow, paving the way for South Africa to rejoin the world's economy.
President Bush, leaving the White House for a trip to Canada, gave his broadest hint yet that the US is about to lift economic sanctions against South Africa. Pretoria had made great progress in meeting demands for reform, said the president, and in Toronto he told reporters a decision would be made very soon.
Yes, the American law is clear, and when the conditions set out by Congress were met, the president will lift the sanctions.
But sanctions supporters in Congress and elsewhere say now is not the time to lift the pressure on President de Klerk.
It does not make sense to jump the gun, to move the goalpost, just at the time when we are about to be successful in moving the political process forward in South Africa.
Well, we will be sending telegrams to President Bush today, asking him, for God's sake, don't lift at this point sanctions against South Africa.
There was, however, support for a careful lifting of sanctions from one of Mr. Bush's predecessors, who feels Pretoria should be rewarded for the reforms it has already implemented.
The White House has emphasized that any decision to lift sanctions will apply to economic commodities alone. The U.S. will continue to refuse to sell military equipment and strategic technology to South Africa in an effort, it says, to encourage further change.
And in South Africa today, there was jubilation at the decision by the International Olympic Committee to allow the country to send athletes to Barcelona. The South Africans know all the world's sporting bodies, especially those in cricket and rugby, will follow the lead, ending a painful episode for their country's sport.
Any relaxation of American sanctions, bringing with it the prospect of major foreign investment in South Africa, will delight the government here, confronting high unemployment and eager for international recognition of political change. Ministers are cautious about predicting President Bush's decision, but there's no disguising their excitement.
If it were so, it would make us doubly happy. It would be a red letter day, par excellence, if I may say so.
A red letter day because this morning's newspapers in South Africa are already celebrating the end of another boycott. "We are back," shouts the headline on Johannesburg's Star. Back in the Olympic Games after 30 years of rejection as racists. "Get set, go," the Sowetan tells its readers in the black townships. And political attitudes among the black majority do seem to be shifting fast. On the streets, we found plenty of support for a return to the Olympics, although opinion is more divided on an end to economic sanctions. The ANC is dismayed at the apparent collapse of sanctions. Their conference last week did endorse a phased reduction in world pressure. The organization does support the ending of sports boycotts, but the ANC wants more in exchange for the lifting of economic sanctions. In particular, the ANC believes an interim government should be set up first, allowing the black majority to share political power while full negotiations on non-racial democracy go ahead.
And we've just heard that the International Cricket Council has agreed in London to readmit South Africa to world cricket. ICC Chairman Colin Cowdrey said the new United Cricket Board of South Africa had been elected to the council with full membership rights. Here, former Treasurer Paul Keating today made his first public appearance since his leadership challenge. Straight away, he bought into a row dividing the Hawke Cabinet. Mr. Keating claims the federal government should use tied grants to the states to achieve a national solution to the housing crisis.
This was no ordinary backbencher and his wife arriving for a speech, but a would-be prime minister, and the media knew it. So too did the seminar organisers. They booked a bigger venue.
Had I known you were able to attract such a crowd, I would have been here earlier. This is a better audience than I got for the budget speeches.
It was a low-key Paul Keating with no pyrotechnics, just a well-written, thought-through speech on the housing crisis in our cities. His solution? New building codes for higher-density residential developments on old industrial sites. He wants function, design, and intergovernment cooperation. And unlike Bob Hawke, he believes Canberra should use a carrot and a stick with the states.
But I believe the tied grant must again play an integral role in refashioning policy.
And how's this for an image boost? Paul Keating signing kids' autograph books. It's carefully crafted and smacks of some sort of campaign. The opposition has no doubts.
And we wish him luck. I know he's got 44 votes there, and some of the boys are very keen to see him get back. And I'm sure we'll be talking a lot about leadership within the Labor Party in the next few months.
Mr. Keating plans to use his backbench freedom to keep his claims to leadership alive. He says he has other policy ideas. We'll be hearing more of those when he feels the urge. But how the mighty have fallen. There was no ministerial limousine to whisk him away. Mr. Keating hitched a ride in a staffless humble Daihatsu. Paul Bongiorno, 10 Eyewitness News.
Two of the prisoners involved in yesterday's breakout from Brisbane's Moreton Correctional Centre have been recaptured. They'll appear in court tomorrow, charged with escaping from custody. But a big manhunt still continues for the six at large, including three convicted murderers.
Michael Raymond Farley arrived at the Upper Mount Cravat CIB accompanied by his lawyer and gave himself up peacefully. It's believed he was talked into surrender by another escapee. Farley was one of the eight dangerous prisoners who made the dash to freedom just after 6 p.m. Tuesday. They used pliers and a ladder to break out of two activities yards, then cut through the sensitised double exterior fence. Five of the escapees then fled in a waiting car, firing one shot before abandoning the vehicle. Although no one was hurt in the shooting, it's believed the drama triggered the death of a prison officer who suffered a massive asthma attack. And a police officer involved in the manhunt died when his vehicle crashed off the road in slippery conditions. For one Chimera couple, it was to prove the longest night of their lives. Two of the escapees broke into their home and held them hostage for almost 7 hours.
There was two of them there and there was only one of me, so I wasn't going to take any chances. No heroes in this household.
Well, they weren't armed and they looked like they were so scared themselves. And they told us that they weren't going to do anything to us. They promised us they weren't going to harm us.
Neither the prison's minister nor the corrective services chief would accept blame for the breakout. Instead, they've suspended three lesser officers and ordered another urgent review into prison security. Meanwhile, the prison officers' union is asking why such dangerous inmates were sent to a jail they say had neither the facilities nor the staffing levels to keep them. Steve Marshall, 10 Eyewitness News.
After the break, the liquidators get to know Alan Bond and the nation mourns the passing of Victor Chang.
O'clock Friday, Harrison Ford plays Ali Fox, a man with a dream.
They think this is a paradise. I'd trade places with him in a minute.
Goodbye, America, and have a nice day.
Takes his family and heads for the Mosquito Coast and into a nightmare where dreams are shattered.
No! 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 No!
The Mosquito Coast, presented by Izzy Dye, 11 o'clock Friday, NRTV.
Why are more taxpayers going to H&R Block?
Most of my clients come back year after year. They know I'll find every rebate and deduction they're entitled to.
With self-assessment, you can't afford to make a mistake. H&R Block know all the changes. They look after all the details and their work's guaranteed.
Their fees are reasonable. And they're tax deductible too.
Come on in and see H&R Block. We're here to help you save on tax.
Lincraft's hottest ever winter sale continues. There's $5 off double velvet, now only $19.99. Plain and printed Allura 12, won't get any hotter. Was up to $5.99, now $3.99. Soft touch that was $9.99 is a cozy $6.99. Style, simplicity and new look patterns are still $2.50. Rug up and sweat in it, down from $8.99 to a hot $6.99. You'd better be as quick as lightning or you'll miss out.
Lincraft.
Danny's Restaurant, the most beautiful restaurant in Australia, with fine Italian cuisine and live music and dancing nightly. Fully licensed and air-conditioned, Danny's Restaurant sits right on the Narang River with beautiful views. Danny's Restaurant, winner of the American Express Gold Plate Award, is open from 6 p.m. Monday to Saturday. Your host, Danny Zolli, welcomes you to Danny's Restaurant, Tiki Village, Riverfront, Cavill Avenue, Surfers Paradise. Phone 382818.
The musical fantasy of Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, live on stage in a record-breaking show. See the forest fantasy and Snow White's wedding, with singers, acrobats and dancers, all live on stage in a sensational show for all the family. Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, acclaimed all over Australia and New Zealand.
Appearing live at the Bar Civic Centre, Thursday, 11th of July, Lismore City Hall, Friday the 12th and Saturday, 13th of July.
At your Team Nissan dealer now, you get your pick of $2,000 worth of free genuine Nissan accessories with any Nissan showing this tick. Plus, you still get to tick off the dealer for your best possible deal. But be quick, offer ends July 31st.
Australia's largest company, BHP, reached a milestone today as its share price hit an all-time high. The Business Review Weekly's Robert Gottliebson.
The stock market has given the new head of BHP, John Prescott, a massive vote of confidence. For the first time, the shares have touched $13.15, giving the company a market value of $20 billion. The share price keeps rising, despite the fact that BHP will be hard-pressed to maintain last year's trading profit. But the market believes the projects BHP has coming forward will double the group's profit by the middle of the decade. At $20 billion, BHP towers over every other Australian company. The next highest is the National Australia Bank, with a capitalisation of $8 billion. The overall Australian market was firmer, with the All Ordinaries Index rising 4 points, led by Brambles, BHP, Western Mining and ANZ. Compass shares rose 1 cent to 45 cents on news that the company was looking to tender for a place on the Australian Airlines share register. The Australian dollar closed at 76.65 US cents. And finally, a message of hope for all those who might be forced to join Christopher Skase in bankruptcy. The bankrupt Australian tycoon has been found to be living in a luxurious mansion in Spain and dining at the best Spanish restaurants, where he thinks nothing of paying out $500 for a family dinner. If you're bankrupt, it helps to have friends or family with money in the right places. This is Robert Gottliebson.
Liquidators searching for Alan Bond's lost fortune plan to take legal action over alleged preferential transactions in his family company. The liquidator, John Lord, has arrived in Perth to take possession of the assets of Dalhold Investments.
The men from Dewsbury's are now in control at the Dalhold office, sifting through a myriad of complex deals, once the cornerstone of Alan Bond's personal fortune.
Oh, we'll probably be in a much better position next week to advise everybody of in full detail of the assets.
What has already emerged, says Mr. Lord, is the possibility of preferential transactions having been carried out, but by whom has not been disclosed. Where necessary, action would be taken to have these transactions overturned for the benefit of all creditors, said Mr. Lord in a prepared statement. Alan Bond is still on the Dalhold payroll and continues to drive his Dalhold Mercedes. He's apparently cooperating fully with the liquidators trying to recover an estimated $1 billion. Dalhold executives dispute the $1 billion, saying the liabilities are probably half that. But one thing is certain, the assets aren't worth much at all, perhaps $17 million. So far, Mr. Lord has found $470,000 in the Dalhold bank account and a string of charges against the key assets, which include a Renoir and 61 Australian paintings. The National Bank has the Renoir mortgaged along with seven Australian works, while Alan Bond's private company, Bond Mining, has a charge over nine others. The art collection, worth an estimated $10 million, is the jewel among the Dalhold assets, but is now extremely hard to liquidate. Even the office equipment at Dalhold is mortgaged to Asander. But on the bright side, Mr. Lord has found the Mosman Tea Rooms, once owned by Dallas Dempster, is unencumbered. So too, the Harbourside facility at Fremantle, from which Alan Bond launched his vain America's Cup defence. The liquidators hope to recover $1 million from Dalhold's Cockatoo Island resort off the northwest coast, but are resigned to getting nothing for Rottnest Island Lodge. They're likely to get nothing either for Dalhold's 72% in Queensland's Yabaloo Nickel Venture, also in receivership. In a complex series of manoeuvres, it's understood that Alan Bond's control over a $30 million property portfolio has been transferred to his family. This is Doug Cunningham, 10 Eyewitness News.
The National Australia Bank has issued a depressing view of the economy. Its June quarterly business survey says despite early signs the country is moving out of recession, business conditions are at their worst for 2 years and unemployment's expected to continue rising. The country's unemployment rate fell to 9.4% for May, but the bank says the June figures out tomorrow are expected to show a rise between 9.6 and 10%. Thousands of mourners today paid a final tribute in Sydney to world-renowned heart surgeon Dr. Victor Chang. Dr. Chang was described as a man of compassion, dedication and vision.
It was not organised as a state funeral. It went beyond that. It was a national day of mourning. Hundreds jammed the doors of St. Mary's Cathedral more than an hour before the funeral began to ensure they were a part of Dr. Chang's farewell. The steps of the church were awash with flowers and wreaths. A police presence and security searches provided a stark reminder as to how the famous surgeon met his violent death. Among the mourners were former colleagues at St. Vincent's Hospital and more than 100 heart transplant recipients who owed their lives to Dr. Chang.
He saved my life twice. It's a day that I wish never happened.
There were many dignitaries. The family, who'd earlier wanted a simple private service, found themselves sharing their grief with literally thousands of people, some of whom had never met Victor Chang. With the cathedral filled to capacity, people braved the wet conditions and stood cluttered on surrounding footpaths to listen to several eulogies, the first from his 22-year-old daughter, Vanessa.
And I understand now, as I did at that moment, why they called Dad, why they do call him a magician, a miracle worker, and a man who worked through God with his two precious hands.
Then came this moving personal tribute.
A little Chinese nun told me that he is surely a saint in heaven. And I can just imagine Dad in his beanie now, grinning down with those white teeth, patting me on the head and saying, everything will work out.
Colleague Dr. Mark Shanahan spoke of Dr. Chang's pioneering work at St. Vincent's.
He became not only an internationally acclaimed surgeon of great skill, but also an ambassador and indeed a true national hero.
Damien Ryan, 10 Eyewitness News.
Still to come, the peace still holding in Yugoslavia and the collapse of the Warsaw Pact means bad news for the British Army.
Lincraft's hottest ever winter sale continues. There's $5 off double velvet, now only $19.99. Plain and printed Allura 12, won't get any hotter, was up to $5.99, now $3.99. Soft touch that was $9.99 is a cozy $6.99. Style, simplicity and new look patterns are still $2.50. Rug up and sweat in it, down from $8.99 to a hot $6.99. You'd better be as quick as lightning or you'll miss out. Lincraft.
Landcare, presented by your local BP distributor.
Wetlands are vital nurseries for commercial and recreational fishing, but they're often the first to fall to developers. At Ballina, close cooperation between the Department of Ag and Fisheries and the local council is turning this around. Careful monitoring of a necessary road and its impact on the mangroves led to council machinery building and seeding replacement mangrove ponds. Now, more wetlands are being created than existed before.
We're starting to get some juvenile fish coming back in. Some wading birds are feeding on the flats, and hopefully within 2 or 3 years' time we'll have some mature mangroves growing up and taking part in providing a nursery area for fish.
Proof that a healthy balance between progress and nature can be reached. To find out how land care can benefit you in your area, telephone free on 008 07 3000.
Landcare is an NRTV rural industry service presented by your local BP distributor.
the best years have just begun. Now we're living at Amity Gardens.
Enjoy Gold Coast living in the security of a first-class retirement village.
We're planning to have some fun. Now we're living at Amity Gardens.
Quality two-bedroom apartments from just $77,900.
It's a great place to retire, 'cause it's simply a great place to be.
Amity Gardens Retirement Village. Phone toll-free 008-074-272.
Hey, Peter, tell the people where to save a big bundle.
Where do you save a big, big bundle? Ask Norm.
Tomorrow only at Norman Ross Discounts, you'll save a big, big, big bundle.
NEC VCRs, $3.99.
Remote colour TVs, $3.29.
Black and Decker toasters, $25.
Sofa beds, $4.99.
Fair dinkum, you'll save a big bundle.
Colour TVs and VCRs.
Fridges and freezers.
Bedding.
Floor coverings.
Computers.
And lots more. Where do you save a big bundle?
Norman Ross Discounts,
tomorrow only.
It's nearly over.
It's a Just Jeans sale. Only $49.95. Now that is cheap.
$14.95 for tops. $24.95.
Just Jeans.
Yeah, we've only got till Saturday.
9:30 Thursday, in the heat of the night, Virgil aims to kill his target, a young girl. The traumas of police work in the heat of the night, Thursday.
Overseas news, European Community foreign ministers are meeting in the Netherlands tonight to work out ways to monitor the ceasefire in Yugoslavia. So far, the fragile peace is holding, but all sides in the dispute are accusing the others of violations.
Today, just hours after the peace agreement was signed, Yugoslavia was making a hesitant move towards peace. The federal Yugoslav army began pulling its troops out of the latest flashpoint in this already volatile country. Under the gaze of Croatian militiamen, the soldiers left a Serbian enclave where a sudden clash yesterday had left at least 13 dead. The fighting had erupted even as the peace talks were underway. Even so, the leaders of the republics, brought together by the European Community, managed to find common ground. And though the sponsor of the talks, the Dutch foreign minister, warned of a difficult way ahead, he felt something had been achieved.
I think that our main objective today has been to try to reverse, to make a beginning with reversing the spiral, the escalation of violence, and to change it into peaceful dialogue.
Yugoslavia's president, Stipe Mesic, was more optimistic, declaring in the early hours that peace begins today. Already, though, cracks are emerging. In Slovenia, where President Milan Kucan welcomed the agreement as a step towards independence, other Slovenian politicians condemned the deal as a sellout, a criticism echoed in Serbia as well. And as the federal government met today, the only republic to endorse the deal was Croatia. It's not a promising start for this third attempt at peace in a fortnight.
Big changes in store for the British Armed Forces. The government is to make drastic cuts to the Army, Air Force and the Navy. Its reason? The Cold War is over and the Soviet Union is withdrawing troops from Europe. The Army is to lose about 40,000 troops, almost a quarter of its strength. The Air Force will be cut by a fifth and the Navy will lose about an eighth of its people. Critics say the cuts are too drastic and the services will be massively overstretched. But the Armed Forces Chief says vast sums of money are being wasted and the cuts are vital. In Bulgaria, a nuclear power station which supplies about 40% of the country's power is to be shut down. The International Atomic Energy Agency recommended the move after experts found emergency systems in bad shape, maintenance poor and a shortage of qualified staff. They claim that the plant at Kozloduy would never get a license in the West, and there are fears of another Chernobyl, given that this plant is similar in design. Two of its oldest reactors will be shut down for good. The other four will not be used again until they're brought up to Western safety standards. And Los Angeles Police Chief Daryl Gates has had to take it on the chin, a scathing report which recommends not only his replacement, but a whole clean-up of his department, which is reportedly full of racism and sexism. An independent commission did the investigation after the widely condemned beating of black motorist Rodney King. It found management had failed to discipline or control violence, didn't respond to civilian complaints, and created a siege mentality. In short, the police department needed a complete overhaul. Gates is standing firm, saying no one should expect him to just run away. Still ahead, Ray Wilkie with all the weather details, and then the candidates for the world supermodel title.
Hey,
8:30 Friday, Nissan Friday Night Football kicks off from Bruce Stadium, Canberra, where the bulldozing Bears meet the rampaging Raiders. Don't miss a hit. Mrs. Anne Casey, instantly healed of a torn cartilage in 1988.
Yes, I was told by two doctors that I would need an operation. But when Gordon Gibbs prayed for me, I was instantly healed. Nobody can ever convince me that miracles don't happen today. I know because God healed me.
Gordon Gibbs, praying for the sick 8 nights from Sunday, July 14. Why not give God a go?
From Milwaukee, Wisconsin, comes another great American export, the Bodines. From their first album, Love and Hope and Sex and Dreams, to their fourth and latest, Black and White, the Bodines deliver what they've become renowned for, great songs. Don't miss their first ever Australian shows. Friday the 12th of July, Club Dart, Waterloo Hotel, Brisbane. Saturday the 13th of July, The Playroom, Palm Beach. The Bodines, American rock and roll at its very best.
Lou? Avon calling.
The director of Batman and Beetlejuice.
Those are your hands?
Would like you to meet.
I think you should just come home with me.
His latest creation.
Whoa, look at my hand check you got there, Ed.
Can I bring the show and tell on Monday?
Edward Scissorhands.
Also screening in a separate session on the same day.
I've always wanted to see the frontier before it's gone.
He arrived as a soldier. He became a warrior. Kevin Costner dances with wolves.
Both films screening in this strictly limited season at McLean, Evans Head, Byron Bay, Tenterfield, Casino, Iluka, Mullumbimby, Kyogle, Mwillimba and Benalbo.
The 11th annual Bridgestone International Kempsey is on, and to celebrate, Bridgestone Australia and Bridgestone Tyre Centres have combined to put on a monster factory-backed tyre sale. Prices slashed on quality Bridgestone passenger and light truck tyres. You can also win one of three sets of Bridgestone Steel Cats, jackets, rugby tops, club shirts, sports bags, and daily spot prices of family passes to the Bridgestone International Kempsey. Make sure you don't miss these great tyre specials. Sale ends July 17. Call to your nearest Bridgestone Tyre Centre now.
There's nothing better than coming home to a warm house.
A reverse cycle air conditioner is also the most energy efficient heater on earth, giving you warm, clean air, economically. Very comfortable, 365 days a year.
Now, here's Ray Wilkie with the weather.
Thank you, Anne. Good night, everybody. Well, there's been some pretty wild weather in southeastern Queensland and northeastern New South Wales in the last 24 hours. A great thunderstorm in Brisbane in the middle of the night woke everybody up. And there's a lot of wind following that with gusts of 70 kilometres an hour. And today was fairly windy too in the city. And around the northern rivers, even though there's no rain today, they have the thunderstorm activity as well. And although there was no rain, along the southern coast of New South Wales got plenty of rain. Let's look at the chart. You can see where it was. There it is. Nothing here today. That is, of course, it all went out during the night, except strong westerlies blowing through here. From the mid-north coast down through here, there was mostly light rain, although on the southern coast, picked up about 22, 25 millimetres of rain through here, and Gabo Island had about 32. Melbourne had an early shower, and then it became fine. Cloudy, though, and there are a few showers coming in from the east now. Around Adelaide, there were a few showers. Perth was OK, and just a bit of drizzle in Hobart. So, except for this weather I've mentioned here, pretty well right. But the temperatures right down, up in Toowoomba on the range, 12 degrees. Canberra was only 8 degrees. Sydney, 11 degrees from minimum overnight, and by daytime, the maximum still only 11 degrees. So, a miserable old day down there, and they only got 6 millimetres of rain. Look at the clouds, you can see. Most of the clouds have gone out. That's the clouds still holding in the coastal New South Wales part. So there's a bit of rain got into the Tablelands as well, and a bit swirled around here into Melbourne. Also Hobart got a little bit. Perth fine. A bit of rain got from about Carnarvon down into about all the goldfields. So we're looking now at the map. These two lows have jumped off over the coast, and of course this is the one that stirred up the air, lifted this air coming in from the tropics here and caused a heavy rain on the southern coast of New South Wales. This one here, of course, did produce the storms as this change moved through last night, and of course drier air has come through the northern rivers, so it's pretty well fine up there all day, and this Butte High, of course, has kept the weather pretty well fine over the whole of the continent. Let's have a look at tomorrow's chart. Well, this low, these two lows will amalgamate, and in doing so, of course, they will gradually move away, so the showers, or the rain first of all, will break to showers from the city
Sydney area and south, and then with time the showers will decrease, the winds will decrease, so everything's coming fine in Butte, and we'll be coming under the influence of this high for the next 2 to 3 days. In the west, another high. Let's get on the forecast now, and you can see there, just a few showers anywhere in the southeastern capitals. Temperatures down though, 10 to 15 degrees, still fairly cool. Although Sydney's going to come up 4 degrees from what they had today, and I think they deserve it as well. All right, see you tomorrow night.
Thanks, Ray. Finally, who's the fairest of them all? Well, we'll know by the end of the week when the Supermodel of the Year is chosen. That is this year's Supermodel of the Year, who, if she wins, will be launched into the high-life, jet-set world of international modelling with a contract worth $250,000. Australia's representative is Perth's Megan Prentice. She's among hopefuls from 35 countries. That's the second edition news for now. Tomorrow on Good Morning Australia, as Dr. Chang is buried, the Chinese community speaks about its fear. Also, controversial British author Geoffrey Archer. I'll see you tomorrow night.